never heard them at all. Till there was you. There were birds in the sky, but I never saw them winging. No, I never saw them at all. Till there was you. And there was music and wonderful roses.
Who gives this woman to this man?
I do. Thank you very much, sir.
Friends, family, and esteemed members of the Benevolent and Protective Order of Elks. Today, we are graced to witness the love and joy of Lou and Karen, to participate in one of the world's greatest moments in modern history, and to recognize the love that unites our two friends, who the paparazzi will undoubtedly name Kalu, or Lou Ren, or perhaps Cortezidums. In any event, you will see it here first, later tonight on TMZ. I really do not believe that I am overestimating or overstating the significance of today. My name is Reverend Juris Doctor Max Rosenberg, and in the very short time that I've known this happy couple, they have changed my life for the better, and I have fallen in love with them, as will all of you if you have not already, once you hear their origin story. So, allow me to take you on a journey to see the beginnings of this Hollywood fairy tale romance. All right. We fade in on a secret princess in dreadlocks consigned to suffering in a convenience store. That's right. Wishing upon a star for her prince to rescue her. Every day, she is set upon by the scummiest degradations of society, the dirtiest of men, until, in Karen's own words, and I quote, the most gorgeous man came in on the pretext of drinking their wretched coffee at Sonny's. He was like Han Solo when he entered that cantina. It was like that moment when Indiana Jones first appeared on screen and faced the camera. He was a young Harrison Ford, only he looked like a young Tate Donovan. And then he spoke to her for the first time. What station is this? A little anticlimactic. Well, Lou, in his own words, says, I don't have game. But that's okay. Because he's Lou. And for Karen, Lou is the game. Lou is everything. David Bowie once sang, love is the opening door. Love is what we came here for. No one can offer you more. You know what I mean. And it was love at first sight. You would think that Sonny would close Sonny's convenience for the day for such a momentous occasion. But he had gone missing after getting in trouble with the State Lotto Commission, and that's another story. Every day, Lou would come in for coffee, cigarettes, and a matchbook as an excuse to see Karen. And Karen was so enraptured with Lou that she would hang out there on her days off, hoping to catch a glimpse of her Prince Charming. I think that Karen said it best when she said, and I quote, my heart would beat so fast, I thought I would bleep my pants. And when he would leave, I felt like I would die. Meanwhile, in the back, poor Lodi, plotting and scheming, her co-worker, hid in the shadows like John Cryer as Ducky in Sweet 16, was it Sweet 16 or 16 Candles, waiting for his moment. But he was no Lou. He was more of a plot device, like the fourth red shirt on the old Star Trek show when Kirk, Spock, and Bones beam down and the fourth guy always gets killed. Still, before our story is over, he plays a pivotal role. See, because both Lou and Karen knew that time was running out to ask the other out, Karen was leaving the country to join the Peace Corps or go to school for nursing, Lou was being called up by the president to stop a meteor from hitting Earth or something, it was Lodi who gave Lou that special matchbook that would change his life. He opened it up to find a little picture of two people sitting under a tree and the words, "Call me," with Karen's number. Now, if Lou had not understood this message, we might all be having a very different wedding here today. Poor Lodi, always a bridesmaid, never a bride. Karen would prepare music in the store for Lou to hear when he entered. That's right, you know what we're talking about here. Special songs that she would borrow from the local library. I think it's important to elaborate here a little bit more about how these two communicated in such cryptic and slightly shy methods. If you've never experienced the power of true love, the awe, you should know that it's overwhelming and often paralyzing. And they were both feeling it. Songs and matchbooks may seem innocent, but I guarantee you, he was picking up what she was putting down, if you know what I mean. In the words of Hesh, from his book, Siddhartha, "Let me say no more. Words do no justice to the hidden meaning. Everything immediately becomes slightly different when it is expressed in words. A little bit distorted, a little foolish. It is perfectly fine with me that what for one man is precious wisdom, for another sounds like foolery." One song that Karen had Lou listen to was The Byrds' "Mr. Spaceman." And forgive me as I butcher this. "Woke up this morning with light in my eyes, and then realized it was dark still outside. It was a light coming down from the sky. I don't know who or why. Must be those strangers that come every night. I hope they get home all right. Hey, Mr. Spaceman, won't you take me please along? I won't do anything wrong. I won't do anything wrong. Hey, Mr. Spaceman, won't you please take me along for a ride?" I'm not exactly certain what kind of message you were trying to send to him in that song. I don't know if she's the alien coming to take him away, or if he's the alien who's going to abduct her. But somehow they made it to their first date. 2 weeks after the matchbook incident, Lou had called Karen's phone, but it broke. In a panic, when she found out, she called him back. And after a 2-hour phone call, they made plans for enchiladas. Now listen, to those of you who are still looking for that special someone, I want to make a very significant point of this. Never, and I mean never, underestimate the drawing power of the romance of enchiladas. Just don't do it. The problem was that neither one of them was sure that they were on a real date. At least not until they watched Talking Heads' True Stories, and Lou said, "Hey, there's room for two on this recliner." See, Lou, you do have game. You were wrong. You got game, right? Then they held hands. Lou knew then that he would never let her go. Then Karen sang 16 Tons, and Lou kissed her. I'm enamored by this story as well. Flash forward several years, and Lou and Karen are hiking Hammonasset Park, and Karen is stuck in the mud up to her hips. She's hungry. She's tired. She's angry. People are laughing at her. She's pissed. So Lou pulls her up out of the mud, he feeds her, and he takes her on a walk. He pulls out a cigarette, and he hands her the matchbook to light it. Of course, the proposal is inside the matchbook. Karen's response, "Oh my God, is this real?" Then she hit him repeatedly. Then she said yes. In Lou's words, and I quote, "I thought I would poop myself a little." That's true love for you folks. Often coupled with incontinence. Listen, don't worry. I made sure to add adult diapers to the, as a registry item. So, John Lennon once said it best when he said, "L'amore è reale, reale è l'amore, l'amore è sentimento, sentire l'amore, l'amore è volere essere amato."